Guys, I am moving, as you might be able to tell. I have a fridge, I have a desk to work on, and I have no kitchen. So this is my life right now, getting situated in here. Actually, let's peek over here. This is the kitchen. As you might be able to tell, I tore out the complete ceiling paneling. That was just these cheap wood panels. I'm putting up drywall. That's gonna be a bit of work. There's still some stuff to do up here. And as you might be able to tell, there's only very little time for videos right now. I guess this is my vacation for the year. Look at those windows. So much light. So much light. I don't know, maybe I'll use one of these rooms back here as a new studio. These rooms aren't huge. They're like 200 square feet or something, 20 square meters. But I might be able to fit like a nice backdrop in here, window over there, cameras back here. I don't know, we'll see. Still very echoey, obviously. But yeah, I didn't want to leave you guys with no video at all, so what I'm going to present to you today is my talk from last year's FabCon. In it, I talk about what the situation on consumer 3D printing is, what needs to change if like the 3D printer in every home is really supposed to be a thing, and whether or not it even should be a thing. I've rewritten a few parts of it, and I think the entire thing is still very relevant to the situation today. So yeah, if you're interested in that sort of stuff, just keep watching and enjoy. So I've been a 3D printing addict for the last 6 years or so. It all started out doing my bachelor's degree, where a friend of me decided to try something new and build a 3D printer from scratch. And at that time, it was a choice between the oversimplified Prusa-Mendel, the original Prusa-Mendel, and the Sells-Mendel. And obviously, we went down the harder route and built this. So this was my first 3D printer, and things were a bit different back then. You couldn't just buy all the parts and expect everything to work. You actually had to figure out every little detail and make it work. And I still fondly remember that smell of burned MOSFET and wood as we tried to add a heated bed to it. So with that background of approaching 3D printing from both an angle of using it as a tool to make things, but also as a project to learn from, and you know, just being fascinated by the technology, I want to talk about why I think 3D printing in a consumer application still has ways to go and, in my opinion, just isn't a valid concept in its current form. So you can basically squeeze 3D printers into three categories. The professional machines, with prices ranging anywhere from 50 to 500k and beyond, and those machines are in a great spot. You've got applications in prototyping, in micro-batch production, and increasingly even 3D printer specific uses like customizing goods or producing structures that aren't feasible with any traditional means of fabrication. Then there's the maker or enthusiast grade machines that I'd actually consider both $3,000 premium machines and $200 Far East kits to fall into this category of more involved users. This bracket also has its specific set of applications, and that's everywhere someone wants to produce things with the machines that he or she wouldn't otherwise be able to buy at the price, or not be able to buy at all because they are fully custom parts for a project or just one-off things you need, so people design and print them. Now, 3D printers aimed at consumers, as in the everyday person, are in a bit of a weird position there. Imagine your typical consumer, someone who goes to an electronics store and buys a 50 euro 2D printer and supposedly goes, hey, wouldn't it be nice to be able to print in 3D too? Now, think about how much they know about the technology behind 3D printing and how much they know about 3D design and customizing things. If you thought, well, they don't know about any of that, then you're on the right track, because they don't. Many consumers don't even know enough about their 2D printers to use them properly. So to stick with that 2D printer analogy, the core reason I see why everyone now has one of them is because they are comparatively easy to use. They are reliable, though some people might disagree here, and most of all, they allow you to do things that aren't easily possible any other way, specifically creating and printing your own documents, photos, cards, whatever you want. That's really the kicker for them. If all you were able to print was pre-made graphics and forms, then what would be the point of even owning a 2D printer when everything it's able to make is also available in a store, ready-made, cheaper, and in better quality? So on the same terms, why would anyone want to buy a 3D printer without having the same level of ease of use and usefulness as a 2D printer? Well, they wouldn't if they were in the right minds. What's still pushing consumers towards owning a 3D printer is plainly marketing, good or bad. When every single Kickstarter printer claims to be the new best machine that now finally allows you to print everything you could ever imagine and even established 3D printer manufacturers start doing the same, then the consumer is just going to give in eventually and just buy one of these damn things if they really are so great. But then what? Sure, they're going to print the first sample files and vases and trinkets from one of the 3D file sharing platforms, but what do they do once they run into the first issue? And trust me, they will. What do they do when a print doesn't stick to the bed or just doesn't come out with the level of quality they were hoping for? Or even worse, what happens once the euphoria wears off and they run out of things to print? Again, I mean, keep in mind, if you're watching this video, you're probably not the consumer demographic I'm talking about here. But still, that's going to be that moment of enlightenment and disappointment when they start asking themselves, hey, what did I even buy this thing for? So really, what makes 3D printers great is that you can produce original things that you come up with and not just reproduce designs someone else uploaded. So that should really be the first thing we as a community and as an industry need to start focusing on, allowing people to more easily create things that truly are their own. And that doesn't even have to be full-blown CAD knowledge for everyone. Even simple things like MakerBot's Thingiverse Customizer are a great start there, since they allow you to change the dimensions, features, letterings of the parts you're going to print. Because that's what 3D printing is awesome at, producing things you can't go out for and buy at the store, like you would when printing exact replicas of ready-made models. It's a start, but creating designs that are completely your own is an even better use for the technology. So somehow we need to work out a way for, no offense, normal people to use some sort of a CAD tool. Now, the thing about CAD and designing 3D parts is, in my experience, that the actual program you use isn't the biggest challenge because frankly 3D CAD programs have become insanely good and accessible in the recent years. So the tools are there. What's the bigger challenge, unless you're regularly creating physical things like building and making structures, is that it's incredibly hard for people to imagine in detail what the design should end up looking like because that's simply not a region of our brains we're regularly using and training. And I realize that is pretty much the definition of a consumer as opposed to a creator. You're often going to see people have an initial idea, but no concept of what it should look like in the physical world. And even worse, the process of then reproducing the design they thought of into a 3D model, that process then doesn't use tools and methods that people are familiar with, or even have a direct physical real-world equivalent to. Sure, clay-like sculpting modeling is very much based on a physical process, but it's a very limited approach that is only really useful for one specific type of 3D model. So I guess the one company that stands out here is Autodesk, and they're placing themselves in that exact void that will need to be filled if more accessible 3D printing is really meant to become a thing. Tools like Tinkercad, that are simply based on combining existing shapes to make new ones, are a great place to start. They're those enabler technologies that give even the uninitiated a chance of using 3D printing in a meaningful way. Sure, the tools aren't perfect and could definitely use a bit of intelligence that tells you how to best 3D print a model and how you could refine it to make it more suitable for the technology. For example, how you could avoid overhangs or orient your part optimally. But still, it's amazing to see what even third graders can achieve with these simple tools. Because they are tools that are very accessible, but still powerful enough. So what I think would really give this area a boost would be 3D printer manufacturers not just selling their hardware, but also going, hey, these are the software tools you can use to make your own awesome stuff with our machines, and this is how you can use them. Now, the 3D printers themselves could use some extra intelligence too. Don't get me wrong, it's amazing to see how far the hardware has come and how sophisticated many of the low-end 3D printers already are, but these machines are still way too complex and way too dumb to properly be used by non-tech kids. Like I mentioned earlier, what do you do when a print doesn't stick to the bed? What if the extruder grinds through the filament? What if a stepper motor keeps skipping on the exact same part of a print every single time? Those are issues even somewhat experienced users might not be able to immediately solve. And frankly, these problems shouldn't even exist in the first place for a user-friendly machine. If you look at 99% of the 3D printers out there, they've all got mostly the same hardware and the same lack of feedback about what they're doing. So, to paraphrase it, most filament-based 3D printers work like they were doing open-heart surgery with their eyes closed, no sense of smell and touch, and someone who also doesn't know how things are looking, whispering into their ears, a bit left, now forward, a plunge down, yeah, you can do it, you can do it. So what I'm trying to say is there is so little self-awareness in these machines that some of them could literally set themselves on fire, melt down an entire axis, and not even realize that anything has gone wrong. They just keep following their routine and hope for the best. And This requires a bit of a change in mentality by the manufacturers. A 3D printer that's usable by everyone shouldn't just have the bare minimum of components to make it function, it should have the bare minimum of features that make it foolproof and reliable even when not used by specialists. And many of these features wouldn't even add that much to the raw component costs of the machine. The biggest part would be that one-time development project for the hardware and the software. And that would include things like sensors for the filament path. So monitoring things like, is the filament loaded properly? Is it being transported properly? Is it running out in the middle of a print? Maybe even a diameter sensor that can compensate for filament irregularities. I've developed one of these, it's not that hard. And by the way, they are not things that are completely science fiction. They are all things that are known to work and basically just waiting for a broader implementation. Then things like ambient temperature sensors, which can either automatically adjust printing temperatures and cooling fan settings, or even suggest to the users that they might want to think about moving a 3D printer to a warmer room. And if a manufacturer really has too much cash to blow, they could even consider adding current and voltage monitoring for each stepper driver to predict when an axis is about to lose its positioning. Editor's note, which is also me, we now actually have this functionality. The Trinamic TMC2130 can report when it thinks a stepper motor might have skipped a step. We're getting there. Still, there are so many options out there that just need to be implemented, but would each make these machines just so much more reliable? Maybe that upfront research and development investment would have to be something done by the community, but because the community now is such a fragmented mess, I think there needs to be at least one bigger manufacturer involved to set a pace and drive the project forward. I'm not really sure who would be suitable for that though. Most manufacturers just seem to be interested in producing closed source machines that are more of the same for maximum profit these days. But it doesn't even need to be entirely new concepts. Even already functioning and commonly used ideas like sensor-based bed adjustment should just already be implemented by every single printer. Not just in the consumer types, because there's just almost no drawback to it, even for the more involved machines. Sure, you can get exactly the same results with 3-point adjustment and a piece of paper, but again, in that case, the machine itself has no clue about how well it is adjusted or whether it is even adjusted at all. And you know, it's not just about adding more to the machines to make them easier to use, it's also about making them better. Most of the time, it's not about feature count or sheer size, it's about how well everything works as a unit. I mean, most enthusiasts can work with even a barely functional product and make them produce great results. Whether that's 3D printer geeks or Linux users, it's the same principle. But most users will prefer something that just works, even if it means they're getting less for their money, at least when it comes to marketable number games, which is why Apple products sell so incredibly well in the IT space. For a 3D printer, that's mostly no-brainers. Use decent components instead of more of the cheap ones and you'll be preventing user headache in the first place. So in the end, even though they look like the same type of machines on the surface, consumer and enthusiast type 3D printers really require a different mindset in their design language. The more involved 3D printers are doing great, by the way. They are very much on the right track when it comes to their feature set, but they are also used for entirely different things than what you're looking at with a true consumer grade product. For the maker-grade machines, whether it's individual products or part of a larger collective like the Enable project that designs and 3D prints prosthetic limbs, there's always a straightforward reason for them to use 3D printing, and the machines and software are already good enough to be used productively by these more involved users. But to really reach, dare I say, the masses, to make 3D printing more than just a fad and actually an appealing concept for everyone, there needs to be a change in pace from just making more the same machines to actually creating approachable workflows and bulletproof machines. I know this isn't going to be an instant event where all manufacturers just suddenly flip a switch. There's a bit too much fragmentation going on in the market right now, but maybe we can start that slow process of convincing manufacturers that 3D printers need to start moving forward instead of just sideways. So that was my talk from last year's FabCon. If any 3D printer manufacturers are listening, I'd love to see what your plans look like when it comes to making your machines not just cheaper, but better, or if you even have plans for that. And if any of you are going to FabCon this year, next month actually, I'll also be there, so see you there. Anyways, thanks a lot for watching and I'll see you in the next one.